I actually remember being really fond of the original Red, but for the life of me, I'd have to go back and watch it again to tell you what the story was. Oh, the setup I remember just fine. Bruce Willis, Helen Mirren, John Malkovich, and others are aging Cold War-era super spies designated retired and extremely dangerous by their respective former agencies who get roped back into a mission. I just couldn't tell you what that mission was. Something about the vice president? Whatever. It doesn't really matter, though, because the setup is the entire appeal of the film. Here's a collection of recognizable, well-respected actors of a certain age, and also Bruce Willis, taking a well-deserved paycheck to do the kind of goofy-ass action nonsense that's typically the province of younger stars. And also Bruce Willis. Plot, stakes, intrigue, who cares? He has old people with weapons. But is the one-joke spectacle of, for example, class-personified Helen Mirren toting around a high-powered rifle and dual-wielding automatic pistols really worth building an entire sequel around? Well, there have not been a lot of peak moments in this year's summer action crop, so yes, sure, I'll take it. The point is, recounting the plot of Red 2 would be pointless even if it made sense, which it doesn't. The film is something like a 90-minute fourth act to the first movie, starting from the basis that we either remember who everyone is, or we just don't care because they're all just playing versions of their career-long personas anyway. The film is little more than a collection of action comedy beats staged in low-rent versions of exotic locales, strung together by double crosses and plot contrivances so arbitrary, I kept expecting the film to dive full-on into some kind of meta-parody about the equally ludicrous storylines of the various Bourne or Taken-style spy thrillers being already funny enough on their own without all the irony, but that would require more effort than Red 2 is interested in investing. It's a paid mini-vacation for its stars and an indulgent grandpa's still-got-it fantasy for its audience, and there's a certain cheerful honesty to that. For what it's worth, the idea of a story is that the surviving Red agents from the first film, plus Mary Louise Parker as Bruce Willis's girlfriend, are drawn back together when a WikiLeaks document about a missing Soviet-era superweapon that must be covered up turns them all into marked men. On the run from layers upon layers of competing and/or backstabbing agency hit squads, they go global to seek the aid of Anthony Hopkins as a mad scientist, comprised entirely of references to Anthony Hopkins' roles, and Catherine Zeta-Jones as a Russian femme fatale from Willis's past. Anyway, they've got to figure out what the superweapon is, where it is, and then how to get rid of it. And then some of the bad guys turn out to be good, and some of the good guys are actually bad, and it doesn't really matter because it's really all about Bruce Willis learning not to fear letting his lady friend in on this part of his life, so just roll with it. Rounding out the cast is Lee Byung-hun as Korean Jason Statham, the world's greatest assassin who has sworn a grudge against Willis's character, but for some reason wasn't called in when they were trying to kill him in the last one. Granted, he also has the much more important mission of helping the film open in the increasingly vital Pan-Asian box office. But no matter, he's a great on-screen presence and he acquits himself well in the fight scenes, plus he gets one of the film's funniest one-liners. It's popular to describe average but inoffensively fun movies as good, but you forget them an hour later. Well, I'm reasonably certain I forgot 90% of what happened in Red 2 while there were still two or three big action scenes left to go. Any other year, that might be cause for a negative review, but I really can't muster up the venom for something this unassuming. Not after a summer that's largely been about disappointment, disaster, once-meaningful icons getting dashed on the rocks. Yeah, you know what? I do in fact remember that I bent over backwards to try and give Man of Steel a mostly positive review. You know what? Things evolve. So do opinions. And ever since I saw that movie, my assessment of it has only decreased. I might actually have to just upright revisit it, so take from that what you will. And maybe one or two real standouts? Hell yeah, bring on the forgettable but diverting Bruce Willis vehicles, because, oh dear God, it's almost August. See you next time! Hey guys, do you enjoy my show? Do you like video games? Will you be in the Boston or New England area on Saturday, July 27th? Because on Saturday, July 27th, Movie Bob, aka me, will be appearing at Kamikaze in Somerville, Massachusetts to sell and sign copies of my new book about video games, Super Mario Bros. 3 Brick by Brick. Brick by Brick is an in-depth, level-by-level, no-stone-left-unturned critical analysis of the retro gaming classic in the form of a novelized Let's Play, a fan's history of the Super Mario Bros. Franchise, and a personal history of growing up in the golden age of video games, and is also available online in print or ebook format exclusively from Fangamer.net. Kamikaze is located at 407 Highland Ave in Somerville, Massachusetts, right in the heart of Davis Square. I'll be there on Saturday, July 27th, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Supplies are limited. I hope I see you there!